Depending on who you ask, opinions about the Russian Sputnik V vaccine will be very different. Half of people will tell you that it is just an untested batch of tainted water that will be injected into unfortunate Russians, and it will probably turn them into ghouls. The other half will say that this is the last hope for mankind, and that while the greedy American corporations are slowly making their horrible vaccine for billions of dollars, Putin is casually saving the world once again. There are also some individuals who will tell you that they just want to microchip the humanity, and that the coronavirus was invented by the world government, but let's not talk about them. Let's try to understand what kind of vaccine it is, whether it really works, and why many are so skeptical about it. So, Russia has begun a large-scale vaccination against COVID-19. In some regions, it started as early as 2 weeks ago, in others it has not yet been worked out. According to Alexander Ginsburg, developer of the medicine, about 150,000 Russians have already been vaccinated. First of all, medical personnel, teachers, social workers, and military personnel. It is true that this vaccination has not become mass yet. At the moment, there are only about 300,000 doses of vaccine available. The production facilities are not ready to produce millions of vaccine samples so quickly, so the authorities promised to start the full-scale campaign only in 2021. At the moment, the production of Sputnik is slowed by one of its components. The production of the first vaccine component based on adenovirus serotype 26 has been more or less mastered by all manufacturers. But the second component based on adenovirus serotype 5 is quite tricky to produce, so its production rate is not as stable as the first one. So breathe out, Russians, at least one more year without autism and microchips in our heads. For starters, some boring scientific information about the vaccine. I should warn you right away that I am neither a doctor nor a virologist, my specialty is biotechnology, so my words should not be taken as some ultimate truth. There are three main types of vaccines that can potentially be used against COVID: mRNA vaccines, protein subunit or peptide vaccines, and vector vaccines. There are also traditional vaccines that use the whole virus, weakened or deactivated. This is a well-known and well-proven technology, but you understand the possible unpleasant consequences here. A deactivated virus does not trigger a long-term immune response well, and with a weakened virus there is always the risk of a rebirth, let's say. Protein subunit vaccines are safer, but determining the best antigen combination takes time, so their development and testing is a rather long process. In addition, it is very difficult to obtain enough viral proteins to make tons of vaccine doses. mRNA vaccines are easy enough to produce, but this is a relatively new technology that has never been licensed for humans. As you can imagine, there are some risks in using such technology. There is one similar licensed vaccine, a DNA one, made for horses. If you identify yourself as a horse, you are good to go. Finally, there are viral vector vaccines, and that's where Russian Sputnik V belongs. They also use weakened viruses, but viruses of a different type, much less harmful. They provoke the strongest immune response, using other viruses as vectors, through which the human body receives the genetic code for antigen. Our body itself then naturally produces antibodies against it. The biggest problem with these vaccines is that they are not as effective if a person has already been exposed to the virus and developed a certain amount of antibodies on their own. So basically, each type of vaccine has its pros and cons. Why is it that the Russian vaccine causes so much controversy and suspicions? The first reason is bias. Mr. Nofakas said it best.
Oh, it's this goddamn Rashka. Yeah, we can't produce anything.
Yeah, for some reason many people think that Russia cannot do anything good, except for vodka and combat bears with machine guns. Of course, that's not true.
You are fake news.
We are not able to produce combat bears with machine guns too, only with vodka. For now. All jokes aside, technologically, Russian research institutes are perfectly capable of creating an effective vaccine, especially since vector vaccine technology was worked out long time ago. Yes, sometimes Russia allegedly uses substances that for some reason don't work the way they are supposed to work. But that's not the case. The second reason is the rather questionable PR that the Russian media provided for the Russian vaccine. First, the drug was presented as the world's first COVID vaccine on August 11th.
Впервые в мире зарегистрировано
вакцины против новой коронавирусной инфекции.
Before any evidence of its effectiveness was published in scientific journals. They were eventually published in a very authoritative journal, The Lancet, on September the 4th. There were also questions about the quality of the publication itself and the data in it, but we'll leave that to the conscience of the journal's editors and reviewers. The question is, why was it impossible to wait with loud statements until the publication? Well, the answer is simple, because Russia wanted to be the first in everything. The world's first registered vaccine for COVID-19. Sounds great. The Russian Ministry of Health wasn't even stopped by the fact that phase 1 and 2 were conducted on a very small number of volunteers before the vaccine was registered. Two groups of 38 people each, that's negligible. For comparison, Oxford vaccine phase 2 was tested with 256 volunteers, Pfizer with 456, Moderna with 600. There were also several strange increases of the efficiency of the vaccine in various press releases. First it was 90%, then it is 92% 2 days later, then it went up to 95% right after Pfizer announced their numbers, and when the hype about the most effective vaccine subsided, it was reduced to its final values, 91.4%. However, foreign counterparts are also guilty of this. The pharmaceutical companies Pfizer and BioNTech first stated that their joint development was 90% effective, later raising the estimate to 95%. The average effectiveness of the British AstraZeneca vaccine was 70%, then they raised it to 95%. The manufacturer of the American vaccine Moderna also reported an efficacy of 94.5% for COVID-19. It feels like all of these companies are just looking at each other, and when someone says their vaccine has achieved a certain efficacy, others just raise their numbers to the same level. The third reason to be doubtful is the most serious. The Russian vaccine did not pass stage 3 clinical trials yet. Yes, this is true. Yes, it's really a serious concern. A preliminary report on phase 3 trials was published in November, and it was claimed that the vaccine was 95% effective. But even the developers themselves admit that necessary trials of the drug will continue until at least May of next year. At the same time, however, they say that the technology to create a vaccine is well tested and the effectiveness is so high and obvious that it can be considered proven based on preliminary calculations. They have a point there. Critics also have a point when they say that the long time frame for testing vaccines is not adopted randomly, and that any side effect may surface after the start of mass vaccination. Let me remind you that in the pre-coronavirus era, the development of a single vaccine took on average more than 10 years. The only exception is the Ebola virus vaccine. Merck managed to develop it in extraordinary 5 years. Now vaccines are ready in less than a year. Will the quality of the vaccine suffer? Will unforeseen problems arise 6 months or a year after the start of vaccination? No one knows. Although, I personally think that the chances of a vector vaccine having these problems are much lower than for mRNA-based vaccines such as Moderna or Pfizer ones. No one can predict how they will behave in each individual's body. Is there any chance that a new, unfamiliar mRNA technology which was never tested on humans will lead to some unforeseen consequences? Yes, of course. Is there any chance that a well-studied but also never fully tested Sputnik V will lead to the same consequences? The chances, although smaller, remain. However, it is worth remembering that the big advantage of Sputnik V is that it comes in two different forms. And freeze-dried form of Sputnik V has the potential to save millions of lives in poor countries, where Pfizer and Moderna vaccines are impossible to use because they require really low temperatures. Would you be willing to take a risk to protect yourself from COVID? The Russian government has decided that it is ready. Fortunately, vaccination for now is purely voluntary, and no one will forcibly inject you with anything, even in Soviet Russia. After all, a second type of Russian vaccine, Epivac Corona, has already been released. It is of a peptide type and it too has not been fully tested yet. But here you can reassure yourself with the fact that unlike vector vaccine, it does not contain any viruses at all. But unlike an mRNA vaccine, the technology of its creation is well known. The immunity from such a vaccine is likely to be less stable, but it can be injected without much fear. Choose wisely, my friend.